guest. I'm Sarah Boehme, curator at the Stark Museum of Art in Orange, Texas, one of the co-organizers of the exhibition. And it's been a wonderful process working with Brigham Young University Museum of Art and all of the people involved with this. And I'm very excited about the exhibition and the exhibition catalog that was a product of this, and you'll be hearing from the essayist this afternoon. I'm going to be introducing and giving all the introductions right at the beginning, and then they will each come up and do a brief presentation followed by a panel discussion. Our first presenter is actually not here. Dean Rader, who is the author of Part of the Strangeness, Notes on Landscape, Branding, and the American West in the catalog, is doing a poetry reading today. He is a poet, and that's one of the voices that we wanted brought into the exhibition planning. And Dean is at a poetry reading, but he did come to the exhibition opening, and the BYU Museum of Art people taped an interview with him, so you'll be seeing that. And we're all looking forward to that. Dean has published in the fields of poetry, American Indian Studies, and visual culture. And his recent books include Engaged Resistance, American Indian Art, Literature, and Film, From Alcatraz to NMAI, which won the 2011 Beatrice Medicine Award for Excellence in American Indian Scholarship. Another recent publication is Landscape, Portrait, Figure, Form, which was named by Barnes & Noble Review as one of the best poetry books of 2013. Dean writes regularly for the San Francisco Chronicle, the Rumpus, and the Huffington Post. He is professor of English at the University of San Francisco, where he won the university's Distinguished Research Award in 2011. Dean's presentation will be followed by John Ott. John, great, that was helpful. John is speaking on I'm going to give the essay titles from the publication. Westward Contraction, Maynard Dixon Paints the Great Depression. And John Ott is professor of art history at James Madison University. And we wanted strong art historians doing cutting edge work. And John certainly exemplifies that, particularly with one of his projects, contribution, his essay, Reform in Red Face, the Taos Society of Artists Plays Indians, won the Patricia and Philip Frost Essay Award for the most distinguished contribution in American art. And so it was a wonderful think piece, which helped many of us as we worked on this exhibition. He is also the author of Manufacturing the Modern Patron in Victorian California, Cultural Philanthropy, Industrial Capital, and Social Authority. His essays have appeared in the journals American Art, American Quarterly, Art Bulletin, Oxford Art Journal, and Winter Tour Portfolio. His current book project, Mixed Media, The Visual Cultures of Racial Integration, 1931 to 1954, has received the support of a Smithsonian postdoctoral fellowship. He is professor of art history at James Madison University. Our third speaker, Jimmy L. Bryan, Jr., is Associate Professor of History, Lamar University, Beaumont, Texas, and studies the cultural history of the early 19th century United States. We wanted this to be interdisciplinary, and of course the vision of historians is particularly important. And Jimmy's research and areas of interest really contributed to some of the context we were able to give to the exhibition. He focuses on the West, cultural frontiers, and U.S. expansionism, with an emphasis on the interplays between genders, sexualities, and violence within written, visual, and material literatures. He has authored More Zeal Than Discretion, The Westward Adventures of Walter P. Lane, and is editor of The Martial Imagination, Essays in the Cultural History of American Warfare. His book manuscript, The American Elsewhere, Adventurism and Manliness in the Age of Expansion, 1814 to 1848, is currently under review. And he is currently visiting scholar here at the Charles Redd Center for Western Studies, another wonderful outcome of collaboration with BYU. Our fourth speaker is a speaker from BYU. Susan S. Rugh is professor of history at Brigham Young University, another historian, but with a very different focus, particularly on the cultural history of the American West. She is author of Are We There Yet? The Golden Age of American Family Vacations, and also Our Common Country, Family Farming, Community, and Culture in the 19th Century Midwest. Her article, notice the title, Branding Utah, Industrial Tourism in the Postwar American West in Western Historical Quarterly, won the Michael Malone Award from the Western Historical Association and a Best Article Award from the Utah Historical Society. She's currently writing a book titled No Vacancy, The Rise and Fall of Motels in America. Our fifth speaker is Elizabeth Hutchinson. Susan's essay for, Jimmy's essay for the catalog is The Weary West, Susan's essay for the catalog is Branding the West for Tourists, and Elizabeth's essay title is Taos and Its Other Neighbors, Intertribal Visiting in Taos School Painting. Elizabeth Hutchinson is Associate Professor of American Art History at Barnard College, Columbia University, another art historian doing a very important research on cultural issues. She is the author of The Indian Craze, Race, Gender, and Transculturation in American Art, 1890 to 1915. She's currently working on a book about early portraits of Native American diplomats in relationship to indigenous sovereignty in the colonial period and the early republic. And our final essayist in the catalog is LeAnne Howe, author of the essay, Imagine There's No Cowboy. It's easy if you try. LeAnne Howe is the author of novels, plays, poetry, screenplays, and scholarship that deal with Native experiences. And of course, she was our wonderful presenter at the dinner last evening. She is an enrolled citizen of the Choctaw Nation of Oklahoma. Her first novel, Shell Shaker, received an American Book Award from the Before the Columbus Foundation, 2002. Evidence of Red, Poetry, won the Oklahoma Book Award for 2006, and Chalk Talking on Other Realities, a memoir, won the 2014 MLA Prize for Studies in Native American Literatures, Cultures, and Languages. Howe was awarded a Distinguished Achievement Award for creative and critical work from the Western Literature Association in 2015. And other awards include a Fulbright Scholarship, a Lifetime Achievement Award from the Native Writers Circle of the Americas, and a United States Artist Ford Fellowship. Howe is the Eidson Distinguished Professor of American Literature in the English Department at the University of Georgia. All of the speakers will be doing a panel at the end, and Marian Wardle will be moderating the panel. Of course, Marian is the curator of American art at the Brigham Young University Museum of Art, and she and I co-authored the introduction to the catalog, Branding's Introduction. She's also an adjunct member of the art history faculty at BYU. She's the author of Minerva Tykert, Pageants in Paint, wonderful publication, and she is editor and co-author of American Women Modernist, The Legacy of Robert Henry, 1910 to 1945, and also The Weir Family, 1820 to 1920, Expanding the Traditions of American Art. And you can see this was a wonderful group of scholars to work with on this project, and we're delighted to have their presentations, and we will begin with that taped interview from Dean Rader. Do I need to? The screen's, yeah.
The screen is. Mm-hmm. There we go. No sound.
At the symposium today. Probably at this. Hello, my name is Dean Rader. I am a professor at the University of San Francisco, and I am so sorry that I can't be at the symposium today. Probably at this very moment, I am in Philadelphia reading poems from one of my books. One of my books, as it happened, one of my books of poems is called Landscape, Portrait, Figure, Form. And one of the things that the poems in this book do is explore the intersection of poetry and painting. I mean, look at the ways that poetry and painting interact with each other, and perhaps even the vocabulary that poetry and painting share. Along with LeAnne Howe. Hi, LeAnne. I miss you. And John, it's great to see you. I love what you've done with your hair. I am a bit of an outlier. I am not an art historian by training. I'm an English professor. But I love landscape, and I'm interested in the ways in which artists, both poets and painters, think their way into landscape and imagine landscape by way of language, either a verbal language like poetry or a visual language like painting and color. And so for me, this was a really fabulous process, not only because I love thinking about the ways in which landscape and language interact, but because I have a particularly special relationship with a lot of the landscapes that are figured in the exhibit. I grew up in a farm town in Oklahoma, but my family on my father's side are all from New Mexico, and I grew up going to New Mexico a lot. In fact, some of my earliest memories are going to Santa Fe and Taos, the very areas that many of the painters are trying to represent in the show. And still to this day, when I think of an exotic landscape, I think of the desert Southwest, which is probably still the landscape in which I feel in some ways the most at home. Maybe my home state of rural Oklahoma, or now the ocean of San Francisco and its beautiful hills seem like bookends of each other. And somewhere in the middle, though, is the desert Southwest that I feel particularly connected to. And for my essay, I wanted to think about the ways in which landscape painting and what we might think of as landscape poetry, or what might be called pastoral poetry, what they have in common, that what poets are trying to do with landscape and what painters are trying to do with landscape might be able to have some sort of conversation with each other. So in my essay about landscape painting, I actually quote some poems by some poets that I admire a great deal, including passages from the great Laguna Pueblo writer Leslie Marmon Silco, who has some of the best ways of thinking about the interactive relationship between people, language, and landscape. So it was fabulously difficult for me to write this essay because I felt a personal and professional pressure to do a really good job. What made working on this exhibit unusually fun was getting to go behind the scenes. As a poet and as a literature professor, I never get to see how exhibits are made. And I've always been fabulously curious about this. So I got to go behind the curtain, both at the Stark and here at BYU, and go into the vault, as I used to call it, and look at the paintings, and listen to the art historians be real smart about color and brushstroke and perspective. And most of the time, I think I was just observing. But I loved the idea of working with real professionals to figure out an ethical and aesthetic way to make this particular exhibit happen, and to make it go beyond merely the pictorial, to address issues of race, to address issues of representation, to address issues of land, and as John talks about in his great essay, to address issues of labor, of the working class, and this really interesting matrix of you know, the political, the aesthetic, the personal, the economic. And I'm really interested also in the ways in which we as a country and as a culture turn to the aesthetic in order to advertise a place or to, as the exhibit suggests, brand a place. And I was intrigued by the exhibit's lens in terms of a kind of metaphorics of looking and how people were looking not just at a people in a place, but looking to maybe construct a kind of bridge between art and culture. And sometimes this comes across a little creepy, perhaps, in terms of how ethnic groups are represented. Sometimes, as in the case of Maynard Dixon, I think he does a great job of representing the grandness of space, the openness of space, and perhaps the optimism that the West and the Southwest came to embody. Personally, for me, I loved working with this really talented group of people. I think Marian and Sarah did a great job of compiling a diverse group of people. I'm really glad that she tapped writers like LeAnne and me to join the group. I'm not sure I'll ever get a chance to help put together an art exhibit again. And I wish I was there to celebrate with you, but you're in really good hands, and I want to thank everyone for all the great work they did, for not laughing at me when I said stupid things in my essay, and for putting together a really good show. Thanks.
Thank you, Dean, for noticing. I think before you are subjected to me, it's important that we take the time to acknowledge and thank the wisdom, the hard work, and the esprit de corps that Sarah and Marian brought to the entire process. So they need their due, right? Yeah. And it really was one of the most, I think, Dean, you get this from Dean as well, it was one of the most stimulating and genuinely collaborative tasks that I've been involved with. And it was just a pleasure all around, so I feel very lucky to be here. For a time during the 1930s, Maynard Dixon departed from his normal repertoire of nostalgic frontier subjects to produce a suite of social realist canvases. First, gritty streetscapes inspired by the 1934 San Francisco waterfront and general strikes. And second, paintings of unemployed migrants adrift in the luminous California countryside. Scholars generally consider these works a brief and unusual detour compelled by the economic downturn and largely unrelated to the bulk of his oeuvre. In my book chapter, I argue that, to the contrary, Dixon's lifelong attraction and contributions to the romance of the frontier West governed his artistic response to the Great Depression. The West's mythic brand, see what I did there, of rugged individualism was so deeply seared into the body of his work that the artist could only define the crisis and possible solutions in personal rather than institutional terms. Driving back from Taos in California in January of 1932, Dixon and his wife, photographer Dorothea Lang, saw destitute migrants along the road, and the painter seriously considered work on the theme of the forgotten man for the first time. Back in San Francisco, hardship surrounded their studio, and Lang made photographs of unemployed men outside his soup kitchen. Then, in 1934, after a two-month waterfront strike, the city erupted into outright class warfare on July 5th, Bloody Thursday, when employers tried to reopen the port with strikebreakers. Soon, the maritime labor action grew into a citywide general strike, which paralyzed the city for 4 days. And, you know, that's what's being referenced by the image on the left. These momentous events drove Dixon towards realist subjects. Like other artists, he mused in 1935, I had dodged the responsibility of facing social conditions, end quote. But the artist's long romance with the native communities of the American Southwest and his nostalgia for the frontier culture of the past together dictated the form and tenor of his pictorial interpretations of the Great Depression. First, Dixon's sojourn to northern New Mexico in 1930 was more than just an escape. It was a pilgrimage. Like many Anglo artists and intellectuals of the interwar era, we've heard a lot about this the last few days, he saw in the region's pueblos model communities whose example could solve the problems that ailed modern commercial and industrial America. For many, the Taos Pueblo first and foremost boasted a deep communal harmony that modern cities lacked. In Dixon's Round Dance, 6 Pueblo men and women hold hands and slightly lift their feet in unison. Their clothing further unifies them through shared coloration and overlapping line. The glow of firelight, warm tones, and slight smiles together create a cheery mood. By contrast, Dixon's San Francisco paintings emphasize discord. Law and disorder dramatizes the conflict between warring factions with slashing diagonals, asymmetrical composition, and a cold raking light. The unease and strain in these strike scenes suggests that urban society is as inherently divisive as the Pueblo is harmonious. Pueblophiles, like Dixon, also stereotype natives as guides to spiritual renewal whose sacred wisdom came directly from their fabled intimacy with the land. In Hopi Man, for example, the broken lines on the sitter's blanket mimic both the distant natural contours and the forms of the earthen structure on which he perches. The Hopi parts his lips precisely along the line of the distant horizon, as though he were breathing in his environment, the source of both his literal and figurative inspiration. By contrast, in his rural depression vignettes, Dixon emphasizes migrants' alienation from the land. In No Place to Go, property owners have already partitioned off the land into parcels far too large for individual family farms. Dixon's reaction to the Great Depression demonstrates that he saw explicit connections and even a kind of causal relationship between the Old West and present-day circumstances. Quote, what kind of people are they, he asked, of the destitute migrants. The same kind that carried the long rifle over the Alleghenies and down the Ohio, across the Mississippi and the plains to the Rocky Mountains. The same kind as Sam Houston and Davy Crockett and Kit Carson. President Franklin Roosevelt also invoked the same frontier mythos during a 1938 fireside chat, quote, there is still today a frontier that remains unconquered. This is the great, the nationwide frontier of insecurity, of human want and fear. This is the frontier, the America, we have set ourselves out to reclaim, end quote. And so Dixon adapted familiar frontier imagery to the Depression, for example, by auguring a dire fate for those homeless men and encumbering them with the familiar iconography of the vanishing Indian. For at least a century, artists and illustrators had proclaimed the alleged demise of American Indians before the inexorable advance of Western civilization. And in like fashion, the painter offers us in No Place to Go a vanishing Okie. This migrant is not merely forsaken and dispirited, but stands trapped at continent's edge. The foreshortened fence line that cascades down a narrow ravine signals his rapidly declining fortunes. The long shadows of late afternoon hint that his time has come to an end. Dixon's realist works ably catalogued the ills that had afflicted the country, but because the artist chose to concentrate solely on the crises begotten by the Depression, it's difficult to ascertain what solutions these paintings might have offered to contemporaries. The use of the term forgotten man, introduced during a 1932 presidential radio address, certainly would seem to identify Dixon as a solid Roosevelt supporter. And indeed, Dixon's moving portrayal of the displaced victims of the Dust Bowl aroused viewers' pity in much the same way as imagery that set out explicitly to promote New Deal programs. Although the painter rarely indulged in lengthy political discourse, private letters do reveal sharp critiques of the excesses of American business. These, however, are entirely absent from his paintings. No identifiable villains appear on canvas. The only pictorial reference to larger social and economic forces comes in No Place to Go as the long-running fence, and even this detail is too generic a symbol for property to read legibly, for example, as the indictment of the consolidation of the farm sector. By comparison, other period imagery of agricultural transformation does address the bigger picture. Lang's Tractored Out, for instance, spotlights the dislocation of subsistence farm families by mechanized, large-scale agribusiness concerns through its title, the dramatic use of contrast and scale, and a low camera angle that turns meticulous furrows into slinking, sinister predators. Dixon's decision to distill complex economic developments down into stories of individual tragedy depends in no small way on the pre-modern West's brand as a mythic space of personal autonomy. Viewing Dixon's depictions of the waterfront strike in tandem with those made by leftist Bay Area artists, finally, dramatizes his more cautious approach. First, the painter is unusual in offering an even-handed portrayal of the war along the waterfront. Radical artists, meanwhile, focused far more frequently on police brutality, for one. In Victor Arnotoff's Down with Fink Halls, the cop is the obvious aggressor. This is a woodcut, by the way. His position on horseback gives him tactical advantage over the pickets below, which the artist exaggerates with the vertical composition and the long arm of the lawman. Moreover, these artists both trace the origins of Bloody Thursday and look forward in time to attest the palpable gains achieved by labor in 1934 and beyond. But Dixon's strikers are more motley and less organized. The episodic nature of his account and the calculated informality of his paintings render the event more spontaneous and ephemeral in nature. No slogans appear to help explain these events. Strangely, not even Dixon's painting Pickets includes the kind of picket signs that are very common to Arnotoff's work. And so, left adrift in Dixon's timeless mythscapes, we know neither why these events happened, nor what might happen next. Thank you.
Push. All right. Thank you very much. I realize now that with some time to think that I may have made a strategic error in putting this little presentation together, but I couldn't pass up the chance to talk about my grandfather for a moment, so if you'll indulge me. My grandfather, Leon Cleveland Tate, was born in 1903. The notation on the back of this postcard says that he was 17 years old when this photo was taken, which, if my math is correct, places it at about 1920. He was born in Clay County, Texas, which is about 100 miles to the northwest of the Dallas area. I didn't know my grandfather very well. He was the father of 14 children and grandfather to about 40 grandchildren. I'm not sure that he ever knew what my name was. But I'm pretty sure he knew that I was one of his. The point is that I didn't get many opportunities to actually sit down and talk with my grandfather. But I do remember one story that he did tell me, and I wanted to share that with you very briefly here. He explained to me that when he was a young man, he had dreams of becoming a cowboy. He wanted to saddle up, ride the range, and wrangle cattle. I'm not sure from what sources he received his information. I doubt he had a chance to watch many of the early Western films of the period. So I suspect that he read about them in dime novels and in magazines, which he still enjoyed reading in his older age. Fortunately for him, Clay County was cattle country, and he got the opportunity to sign on as a hand at a genuine, or should I say authentic, cattle ranch. And he told me about his first day as a cowboy. He said he got up before dawn and he worked all day, mending fences, hauling hay, and a variety of other tedious jobs, working in the heat of the late summer, working until sundown. My grandfather told me that his first day as a cowboy was his last day as a cowboy. One day was enough to satisfy his boyhood fantasies. I find this interesting for a variety of reasons, but not the least of which is that at the time that he posed for this photograph, about 1920, William Herbert Dunton had decided to paint the cattleman Zenas Curtis in the first of a series of compositional portraits that often, but not always, featured old men. Now, when Sarah and Marian invited me to participate in this project and tour the collection at the Stark Museum with my fellow panelists, one of the images that I was struck by were the many images of old men and weary people portrayed by artists like Dunton and E. Martin Hennings and Walter Ufer, names that I did not know at the time. I have since learned that many of these artists got their start illustrating the popular fiction of the West that my grandfather may have read. I'm sorry, fiction that required illustrations of the Bronco Buster, the Gunfighter, the Lone Rider, the traditional images of Remington and Russell and Wyeth. Many of the images, of course, that we have here are part of our exhibit. I was surprised that even by the 1910s, artists like Dunton, Maynard Dixon, and others had become disenchanted with these images, describing them as stale, trite, and inauthentic. To find something new, or as Dunton said, to find the unadulterated real thing, they traveled to Taos and other parts west. They were looking for something authentic, perhaps. But as Professor Deloria's lecture yesterday morning suggested, and a discussion earlier this morning with Mindy Bisaw and Phil Schneider reminded us that authenticity is a very highly subjective idea. And as my fellow panelists, pardon me, and the wonderful lectures that we enjoyed here this weekend at the symposium have shown us, the West is possessed by many multiples of authenticity. But I was drawn to these figments of old men, of figments of toil, weariness, melancholy, and even figments of resentment. And in my article for the collection, I write about how artists express the weariness of the West in several different ways, and I'll mention a couple of them here in this presentation. One of the authenticities that artists like Dunton, Hennings, and Ufer discovered was that working-class Westerners were no different from their counterparts in the East or in the North or in the South. They consisted of different ethnicities. And in contrast to the myth of the Bronco Buster or the Gunfighter, they did not enjoy the ability to impose individual dominion over their world. Ultimately, the only capital that they possessed was their youth and their bodies, and they sacrificed both. I find this particular image interesting because it contrasts the authenticity, if you will, of work with the inauthenticity of romance. For most of us, the adobe architecture is a very familiar part of the romance of the West and the Southwest more specifically. But here, Ernest Blumenschein reminds us that constructing and maintaining this romanticism requires a lot of work. Walter Ufer also does this in a painting called Builders of the Desert, which appears in the catalog, showing the backbreaking work of Pueblo Indians molding adobe bricks. And of all the artists, I think Walter Ufer probably identified most with the workers of the West. This was perhaps reflective of his often troubled relationship with his wealthy patrons. And he expresses this affinity in his meta-portraits that John Ott writes about, and where he positions himself alongside his longtime model, Jim Marable. He also shows the drudgery of women at work, Native women in particular, carrying water vessels on their heads, and here showing a woman burdened with a bundle of laundry as she walks by a graveyard. He also shows this in his last completed painting titled Bob Abbott and His Assistant, which you'll also find in the catalog, in which he apparently portrayed himself as an old, worn-out automobile in need of repair. I was also moved by the way that Western artists interpreted the Great Depression, which John Ott also talked about. Often these artists that we considered recorded how the crisis of the Depression deepened the estrangement between Westerners and their cherished myths, how it fundamentally challenged their faith and self-reliance. And I just wanted to show a couple examples here that illustrate this point. I talk about this painting in my essay. Unfortunately, we could not locate it for inclusion in the catalog. This image is taken from a publication from 1985. But if you're at all familiar with the work of E. Martin Hennings, you can see how this is very much a departure from that more familiar work. Hennings' paintings are filled with sunlight, almost garish sunlight. His men and his figures are often squinting from the brightness, and clearly the sunlight is smudged out in this rather gloomy painting. There's Hennings also paints a number of works that show natives walking through these pristine, serene, I think is the word I'm looking for, groves of trees. I guess aspen, perhaps, is the specific type of tree. But here is something quite a bit different, where he's showing an episode that takes place in Taos when a New Deal agency, I think it was 1934, where they commodified livestock in order to purchase livestock in order to reduce the numbers of their livestock. And they would come into places like Taos, select the hundreds of animals to be slaughtered, and apparently in the most gruesome way. And as you can see, these women from the Taos village were... I mean, I don't have to explain it to you. You see the grief and the perplexity on their faces. Even the New Deal agent, who's anonymous here, turned away from the viewer, has his hand stuffed in the coat. He's helpless to meet the appeal of these two women. And of course, John has already shown us some examples of Maynard Dixon. I like this one in particular because it contrasts so much with the landscapes that Dean Rader talks about with Dixon. Dixon's landscapes are filled with these impressive vertical structures. They're filled with multicolored stratigraphy. Some examples, of course, you see in the exhibit. Skies are filled with these just majestic, puffy cloudscapes. I mean, you don't see any of that in this painting, Destination Over, which I believe is part of this Forgotten Man series that John talks about. And here you see that the desert is just an indistinct horizontal landscape. The mountains are reduced to tiny monochromatic figures, and the sky no longer filled with clouds, but with just this indescript fug, for lack of a better way of putting it. So there are just some of the weary ideas of the West that I talk about in my essay, and I think that's about it for today. Of course, we'll have time for questions later.
Well, as others have expressed, I felt so lucky to be a part of this group, and the invitation came to me at a very difficult time in my life, and I think that Marian is responsible for rehabilitating me as a scholar at a time when I thought I might quit. So I really appreciate being included. I was often conscious of being a historian, not an art historian, especially when somebody said something like, "You keep using these paintings as evidence." And as a historian, I'm like, "Yeah? And is there a problem with that?" And I remember very clearly walking into the Stark Museum. It was just a vault of treasures. It was like walking into a candy store, and around every turn were more beautiful paintings, and you just wanted to just float around in there for days. And like Dean, it was not something I had experienced before, putting an exhibit together. And it was so collaborative. And I remember we would go and put our list together of what we thought should be in the exhibit. And then we put all these images out on a table. And then the fight begins. What's going to stay? What's going to go? What are our themes? And the biggest discussion was, well, what are we going to call this? So I think, like Jimmy, I just quietly withdrew and let them duke it out. And I think it turned out all right. So I was invited into the exhibit for my expertise on tourism. And tourism is often regarded as the Trojan horse. Once you let it in, the civilization is completely destroyed. And I think that's often the way we see it in the West. So I started looking at these paintings and trying to figure out what relationship did they have with tourism. And I just want to talk about a few of the paintings. And Marian, just raise your hand when it's time for me to stop, because I don't see a clock here. Is it here? Anyway. So basically, I argued that without tourism, there would have been no Taos School of Painting, that essentially they aimed to popularize the Indians, and they made their money on this, what Elizabeth has called the Indian craze. And this all happens right when roads are being built and automobile traffic is starting to overtake railroad traffic, because Taos is not on a railroad line. And the railroad line comes to Santa Fe, and the railroad company is very clever at fitting out cars and training young women and dressing them into kind of quasi-Navajo-looking Indian outfits and having them take these tours. So I told the story of these tours. And Kaus, who painted this, pretty romantic-looking painting, I'd say, a shy couple, a shy courtship. He was one of a number of these artists who did paint images for the propaganda, the brochures, the pamphlets, the schedules that the railroads put out to try to get people come west. And this is an Indian-centric Southwest. This is not the cowboy and Indian West. This West that they're depicting is centered on the Indian. The Indian is seen as the primitive, as a lost race. A second painting, I think, explains this quite well. So this is by Oscar Edmund Burninghouse. And let's see, we have, does this make an arrow here somewhere? Let's see. Here we go. So if you see right here in the painting, whoops, I don't know what I did. Push what? The up arrow. Oh, I just changed paintings. Okay, great. Thanks. So I just kind of go back an image.
I tried to use the clicker.
There we go. All right, I'm not going to touch it. You're just going to have to look at it. So if you see over at the left, there are two rather large-looking men, and these are our tourists. And the reason you can tell they're tourists is because they have these box cameras in their hands. And actually, I think they're bigger. They're a little bit big for actual size of the cameras. But here we have the fiesta crowds in San Juan. The Pueblo is celebrating its annual festival, and the tourists are starting to come. So we have here the covered wagon, the Old West, meeting the cars and the cameras. And the camera, of course, is a new way of looking at the West. So this is a picture from 1922, and the exhibit label points out some other ideas here in this, but I want you especially to notice this, the tourists, and the tourists coming in. And more people came to this area. And this was not able to be loaned, but it is in the exhibit catalog. And this depicts the races in the Pueblo, Taos Pueblo, that take place in September around festival time. And the town of Taos kind of tried to move these a little bit forward to take advantage of the tourist craze, but you can see people standing on the roofs and looking at these racers as they come through. And these large, colorful celebrations, the woman in the front, you think it might be possibly windy. She's holding on to her serape or her shawl, I guess I'll just use a generic term. And these kinds of festivals really drew people to Taos, ceremonial games and foot races. And I just wanted to read you one excerpt from a guidebook. This is Frank Trago, and this is published in 1929. The book is called Boulevarded Old Trails in the Great Southwest. He said, tourists have invaded the Indian country of the Southwest. Over roads once traveled by the conquistadores, the sightseeing buses now honk their way. And as the tourists approach, Trago alleges that the Indians rush to put white buckskins on and lay out cheap Indian artifacts and blankets made in Connecticut. He bemoaned the commercialization of the Indian customs, arts, and ceremonies. And he wrote, some even put on a headdress of feathers and posed before the snapshot fiend for 25 cents and some for a dollar. So again, the camera, the snapshot, represents the tourists here. This is a picture of the front of one of the Indian detour brochures that advertise these auto tours in the Southwest. And look at the enlargement of this mesa here and the small Indian with the basket and then the car. The car is central here in bringing in the tourists. And in the shadow of the mesa is Pueblo. The Pueblo, the authentic Pueblo where the Native Americans lived. So it has become very small and the features of the scenery have become exaggerated. This final picture that I want to talk about is Oscar Edmund Burninghouse again. And I think it says 1922 on the label upstairs. I'm not certain of that. If we are certain, I'd really like to know that. And for me, this collage, this mural, brings together all of the elements. And if you see, the painting kind of has at the top area is the Spanish. And of course, they were conquered in 1848. And then the conquistadors coming in on your upper right. If you look at this painting at the lower left, then you can see Indians represented, the Native Americans represented. And opposite that, over across the painting, there are the Anglo symbols of the gambler and the cowboy and the fisherman, the sportsman. And they're all coming in and in the center of the painting. And I know they look like aspens, but there are also cottonwoods up there along that valley. But right next to them, in the center of the painting, almost, is the car. There's the automobile. Behind it, gasoline pumps. And who is there in the middle but a man and his wife behind him? He's holding a camera. And I am not at all certain who that figure is behind the woman in the kerchief. Sometimes it reminds me of Marlene Dietrich, so I have no idea. But I think this is a painting that symbolizes New Mexico's tourist claims that they are bringing all these cultures together. And you can see all these cultures, the timeless Indians, the conquistadores, and the white people there in New Mexico. So in a sense, this is a tourist image. It's created for tourists. And it certainly is apropos at the time of the WPA guide. So if you look at this, I think, let me just close with my own words. If one believed the hype, one would have thought the Spanish had not brutally quelled the Pueblo Revolt of 1680, nor that the United States had won its war with Mexico in 1848. Taos painters helped draw the tourist crowd west in their shiny automobiles. Armed with cameras and money to buy souvenirs, tourists consumed the Southwest in search of an unchanging place that never existed. Thank you.
You all know, and that was really awesome, but I should also just make sure that you all know that we ate many excellent meals together and spent lots of time speaking over, when on campus, glasses of water and incredible truffles, and when off campus, sometimes glasses of other things as well. So it was really a journey of getting to know one another and getting to know the work through the eyes of one another that is really precious. And I want to start with just a couple of comments, but I'll give you something pretty to look at. This is not the piece that I thought we were starting with. So, okay, I'll wing my beginning. But anyway, a couple of things have been going on for me in this wonderful set of papers that we've been able to hear in the last few days, in which certainly some of the sociability and hospitality that we experienced has been extended to you all. And one of the things that's been on my mind a lot and a lot of my questions are things about what's able to be shown and what's not able to be shown in the visual cultures of the West, and what we might think about what's marginalized or not shown in this kind of work and why. And I'm very mindful, of course, of the operations of racism and settler colonialism and other kinds of things that have made many of these depictions operate under the constraints that we now have really been rehearsing quite well, or the constraints imposed upon them. I've also been thinking a lot about one of my early mentors, Robert Warrior, who, when I undertook a dissertation project in which I was looking at both representations of Native people and also representations by Native people, he suggested to me that I needed to be mindful in my work about creating work that was going to be useful for later generations of Indian people. That should actually be a leading criteria for the kinds of decisions about what I would undertake and how I would undertake it. And I'm really appreciative that Dean mentioned ethics, because I think there's an ethics in examining works of art that themselves record marginalization, but also perhaps a call on the part of someone like Robert to go beyond simply documenting marginalization to beginning to think through ways in which we might undermine that. And so Robert, I think, helped launch me on a career in which I've been trying to think about how my social justice commitments outside the academic realm might also inhabit some of my academic work. Now, one of the things that really became possible in the research that we were doing was we looked really closely at the work. Jimmy was surprised to find so many tired and old cowboys, so different from what we expected to see and maybe had been trained to see by people like Frederick Remington. I was surprised with pictures like this to see that if you look closely, the Native peoples represented in many of the crowd scenes of Taos are actually very heterogeneous and diverse. I was quite interested in the fact that what we see in a picture like this one, which is not at all the picture I thought I was starting with, is Taos people and their Apache neighbors. And if we move to a picture like this one, we might be able to see, and this represents a fiesta at Okeawinge Pueblo, south of Taos, related linguistically and in other ways to the Taos Pueblo, people who might clearly come from this venue, but also a man here in a white blanket who, and some of the figures in the background, who seem to be actually wearing the typical clothing from Taos Pueblo itself. And perhaps we might even begin to see others. In addition to seeing intertribal visiting, which became then the sort of theme of my essay, we also see intergenerational exchange in these paintings, and I pointed out in my essay, and I was pleased to see that it made it to the wall, that this figure, this tableau right here in the foreground, shows a mother, or at least an older woman, dressed in the manta, typical perhaps of feast day dress for this community, and right in front of her is this young girl in a beautifully clean starched dress with a hat and long braids, who I think might have been released from the oppressive structures of the boarding school education system to come home for this feast day. And she's welcome home, right? And she's integrated into this community despite the kind of different moment that she, or the different experience that she's having from the family that she has left behind. And in thinking about this, I became quite interested in how intertribal visiting could actually be best understood as a strategy of cultural survivance in the Southwest. And although we are certainly not ascribing to Burninghouse or Hennings or any of these paintings an interest in preserving or extending cultural tradition, because many of these artists were trained in a realist tradition in which they were actually recording what they saw as the basis of the sketches of the works that they made, they have some of that indexicality that we frequently attribute only to photography. There's some details in here that, while they might help the pictorial functions of the pictures, also are meaningful to us. So let me now jump into my text, and I'm going to start with a description of this other painting, which you can see upstairs, which is a LeAnne Gaspard painting, and I'm sure I just asked for the wrong one. I'm sure it's me. Of Apaches en route to the Christmas dances at Taos. And sometimes when we look at this, I mean, when we think about tourism, we might think that actually, strategically, since these guys are supporting the tourist industry, it's good for them to put the tourists in the back. And maybe, in fact, there were more tourists here, but they're putting the colorful indigenous people in the foreground. But I ask the question, what if we were to read the visitors at that we see in these paintings not as stand-ins for white people or there to appeal to a white view, but as contemporaries also participating in the visiting around feast days? What if we think about the journeys of these people to these pueblos not as part of an unchanging tradition, that myth of the West that is supported by this work for white consumption, but instead as an aspect of modern indigenous life that nourished ties between neighboring tribes in ways that might serve present needs as well as maintain old traditions? So I'm going to cut and move forward. So one work I unpack along those lines is the one that I'm showing you now, and I've described it a little bit. And by calling attention to intertribal visiting in my essay, I connect scenes depicted by Taos School artists with centuries-old practices in the Southwest that mixed cultural and economic exchange with ceremonial practice. As the paintings show, Taos culture incorporates cultural traits associated with the tribes of the Great Plains, as well as those linked to the pueblos further south along the Rio Grande. Taos men's attire includes buckskin, braids, and sometimes even eagle feather bonnets. So they're not all 25-cent things that are made in the East, but certainly also part of a local tradition. Taos people use Apache baskets, Navajo textiles, and animal pelts obtained through trade with neighbors from the Great Plains. And this hybridity reflects Taos's location at a point of contact between Southwestern and Southern Plains people. Along with raiding, intercultural trade in the Taos region actually constituted a two-pronged mutualistic relationship by which indigenous peoples competed for resources, furs, food, even human captives, each indigenous group providing things needed by the others. The Spanish introduced manufactured goods into these exchanges, and in 1723, they limited trade in the region to two locations, Taos and Picos, and established an annual trade fairs held during the summer months that continued with few interruptions for over a century, incorporating American and Canadian trappers when the fur trade brought them into the Southern Rockies. So Taos is really a center of trade that connects it to a much broader world, and these pictures are artifacts of that, even as perhaps the romantic story suggested isolation and no historical iteration. After U.S. annexation of New Mexico, government reforms put an end to the hunting that was the backbone of intertribal trade and used education, missionization, and vocational programs to modernize Native communities. But as anthropologist Elsie Clue Parsons recorded, the demise of the Taos trade fair in the reservation era only meant that trading practices were relocated, and in this case, relocated to the space of the fiesta. And in fact, dancing and exchange were already a significant part of intertribal gatherings. So not just feast days, but other modes of coming together often included ceremonial practice. And this ceremonial practice included things that themselves were exchanged. So Taos dances incorporate costumes and drum beats from the Southern Plains, many of which were given to them as the result of warfare or trade. Silvio Rodriguez has theorized that dancing was not only a pastime that accompanied intercultural trade, but that it actually offered a ritualized opportunity to reinforce, break, and consider cultural boundaries between groups engaged in an ongoing cycle of conflict and mutual dependency. And this painting is hanging up upstairs. I'll go back to the other picture in a moment. But this is the so-called Comanche dance, and it is a dance done by Taos people, but that ritually expresses their experience of Comanche imperial expansion into their territory and the various ways in which Pueblo people and their Apache neighbors responded to this through ritualized performance, but also through other forms of mediation. In this painting, Taos people dress as plains warriors, often offering a buffooning depiction of these neighbors' behavior while wearing headdress, bustles, and other examples of plains attire, frequently obtained through barter, even barter at ceremonials where the dances were performed. In my essay, I argued that the well-known dance controversy of the 1920s, in which the federal government sought to suspend or reduce ceremonials as part of the assimilation party, policy, impacted more than the religious lives of people at individual pueblos. It also attacked inter-pueblo and intertribal economic and political relationships that had been developed over centuries at sites like the ones depicted in the paintings. However, I want to point out that the controversy also spurred a renewal of such alliances. Now, much has been written about Anglo-reformers' interest in preserving Pueblo dancing, often for their own romantic needs. But it is essential to understand that the leaders of Native communities were also involved in protecting their cultural practices. In November 1922, the All-Indian Pueblo Council, shown here, a group that included governors from each of the 20 pueblos in New Mexico, was convened to discuss the Burson Bill and these developments. The council had met since 1598. So political alliances between these pueblos were long-standing, and they met to discuss collective responses to colonial impositions on Pueblo land and rights. Different pueblos had adjusted to the Anglo presence in New Mexico in a variety of ways, but at times it was useful for the pueblos to speak with one voice. Significantly, the council did not initially adopt the language white reformers used in their opposition to the Burser Bill, which was largely to say that dancing should be preserved as religious expression under the Bill of Rights protection of religious rights. Instead, they issued a statement that reads, quote, "This bill will destroy our common life and will rob us of everything we hold dear, our lands, our customs, our traditions." Rather than seeing religion as something independent from economic and political exchange, from community building and visiting, I argue that these customs and traditions that they depict bring all of these different confluences together and, in fact, represent a more Native-centric way of looking at this moment in history, and one that I think is visible perhaps in the pictures themselves, despite maybe the painter's own ability to see that. My essay ends by considering some of the ways in which the intertribal exchanges that take place around dancing persisted and expanded through the 20th century and continue to be vital today. Powwows, including one held at Taos each summer around the time of the old Taos trade fair, are gatherings that mix ritual, commerce, and conversation in ways that can restore and expand Native people's relationships to their communities and their indigenous allies. And I note in particular the presence of dancing in recent political protests supporting the preservation of Native rights, such as the Idle No More movement. In sharing these thoughts with you, I want to just reiterate that I hope that our scholarship can lead to something more than just exposing the problems that are built into artworks of the past, but also, and I'm taking a note here from Phil Deloria's flirtation with the utopianism of modernism yesterday in his talk. So more than exposing problems, I hope that we can offer and experiment with ways to envision a very different future. Thank you very much.
Wow, we've come to the end of it. Again, I want to thank the people whose land this is. I want to thank Marian and all the wonderful staff at MOA and BYU who have been so generous in opening up this conversation. And all the hard work from my colleagues that went into the Branding the West, the American West book. And I'm honored to be part of that collection. So this is my talk. So imagine there's no cowboy, and it's easy if you try. I asked Marian to use this squaw man image from the movie Picture World, Moving Picture World. This is a Lasky presentation of the squaw man. And I would argue in my work that this, not much has changed since this film was made, and really the plot of the film in that Indians must die. And while he marries and makes a child with an American Indian, she dies and the child is sent back east to receive a proper education and become human. Away from the confines of tribe and tribalism. So human memory works this way. The brain replays a pattern generated in response to a particular event or events, but replays are not quite the same as the original event. My memories of watching Indians and stampeding horses may not exactly be correct, but they are memories that recycle over and over from my childhood to adulthood. I'm 12 years old and stretched out on a grass-colored divan in our living room, watching tiny raindrops from our evaporative window fan swamp cooler hit the linoleum floor. I've had rheumatic fever, and it's left me with a heart murmur. I'm supposed to rest, but the sights and sound of horses galloping across the TV screen and in my visions make me want to jump up and run outside, but I can't. I'm sick, with nothing to do but watch television 7 days a week. I'm the original couch potato, a red-skinned one at that. Viewing afternoon movies, scrutinizing the Friday Night Late Show and Saturday morning reruns, all Hollywood westerns. Indians are branded in films as the bad guy in classic Hollywood westerns. What I learned from these movies is that we Indians must die in order for white settlers to live. In the mid-60s, during my year-and-a-half confinement on the couch, my brother would often park in front of the TV on Friday nights and keep me company. What follows is more or less an accurate account of our dialogue after seeing a weekly Western on Oklahoma City's Channel 5. "Stupid," I say, as the end credits roll. My brother shrugs. "What do you expect? It's Stagecoach and John Wayne." Some might call this rhetorical style stoic. I prefer concise. Same time next week, another Western, Indian shot to pieces. Crap. "What do you expect? It's Arizona and Gene Arthur," says my brother. The following week, crap. "What do you expect? It's Duel in the Sun and Gregory Peck. And you know, Indians must die." By now, you know what I said. "What do you expect? It's Broken Arrow and Jimmy Stewart." And I can't tell you what I said. "What do you expect? It's Broken Lance and Spencer Tracy. Indians must die. Criminy." By this time, I'm developing some verbal skills. "What do you expect? It's The Unforgiven and Audrey Hepburn. I take the Lord's name in vain." "Crap," says my brother. Then one Friday night, Channel 5 had a salute to silent films, and I think we watched the 1917 film, which I write about all of this in my essay in the Branding the West book. But I think we saw Wild and Woolly. And again, this is my memory recycling it. And this film is with Douglas Fairbanks. It could have been one of Fairbanks' other terrible silent films, such as The Mask of Zorro, but in my memory mashup, it's Wild and Woolly, the story of a young white man pining for those happy days of yesteryears in which Indians must, well, die. And you know how the story goes. Back to me and my brother on Friday nights. The movie's just ended. What do you expect, I say. It's Douglas Fairbanks. Wait. What did you say? Douglas, what's his name? Or whatever it was, is a terrible actor, says my brother. Don't expect me to watch another one of these silent movies for as long as I live. I'd rather have a little needle stuck in my eyes. Now, some siblings play a sport or a favorite board game that brings them together as a family. For us, watching Westerns was that shared experience that brought us closer together, like weathering a storm in a small raft at sea. Most all Westerns have a similar message. Indians must die or go quietly into that good night. So my part in the book of Branding the American West is to haunt the images of the old Westerns and navigate that landscape as so many of my colleagues have navigated the landscape of the paintings in the collection. As Chickasaw scholar Jody Bird says, Indianness can be felt and intuited as a presence, and yet apprehending it as a process is difficult, if not impossible, precisely because Indianness has served as the field through which structures have already been produced. In other words, Indians have already moved past the frame of reference, but the haunting remains. American films are symbiotically connected with the images of Indians as a baby's umbilical cord is to its mother. We remain tied. We identify in film what an American film is. Psychologist and University of Arizona professor Stephanie Freiberg has shown in her research that the effects of Indian stereotypes result in low self-esteem, lower grades in school, and contributes to high dropout rates of American Indians in high school and colleges. And that's certainly true today. We have the highest dropout rate of any other group in North America, usually at the seventh grade level. Contemporary American Indians, for example, exist beyond the reach of Americans, and I'm quoting from Freiberg. That is, most Americans have no direct personal experience with American Indians. The relative invisibility of American Indians is, in part, the result of population size and segregated residential living. American Indians constitute 1.5% of the American population. American Indians, about 34% of American Indians live on reservations, according to the U.S. Census Bureau 2006. Moreover, only 57% of American Indians live in metropolitan areas, which is the lowest metropolitan percentage of any racial group. One consequence of this relative invisibility is that the views most Americans have about American Indians are formed and fostered by indirectly acquired informations, i.e. media representation of American Indians, and also museum exhibits. And I can talk a lot more about that. I was an early consultant to the NMAI museum as it was being built. Freiberg goes on to explain that the negative impact of natives' self-esteem as a consequence of seeing, viewing, and being confronted with stereotypical representations of American Indian imagery is endemic in the United States. Quote, American Indian mascots and other fictionalized idealized and non-contemporary representations may be associated with low self-esteem and in-group ratings because they do not provide guidelines or images for how to realize positive and contemporary selves. We don't have the tools to navigate, especially as young kids, especially as people in their early teens, we don't have the tools to navigate out of this contemporary loop, this systemic sickness of the stereotype of American Indians. And I will also argue that the reason that we are invisible to a large extent is that most Americans can't identify American Indians because we aren't walking around with the headdress on. Furthermore, Freiberg's research explains why my brother and I became such cranky social critics. And in my case, it may be a virus that continues to get worse as I age. Each week, we watched as American Indians failed and failed and failed and continue to fail, either by deed or by way of life, and we were vanishing or slaughtered so that white people may live as happy settlers on our lands stolen from us. Okay, there were treaties. Unless we as Americans join together in the 21st century to change the story, I'm afraid resistance is futile. Another Hollywood cliche. But it is not. So I kind of leave you with this thought. What can you do? What will you do? How will we do this together? Indians in headdresses continue to show up in contemporary movies. Films as wide-ranging as Da Lovely, 2004, The Birdcage, 1996, Blazing Saddles, 1974, Hidalgo, 2004, Ma and Pa Kettle, 1949, all containing random stereotypical images of Indians that early filmmakers like Lasky solidified, as do other forms of media from consumer products such as the Land O'Lakes butter, Jeep Cherokee, Red Man chewing tobacco, and sports mascots such as the Washington Redskins. Any of the films that I talk about in my chapter in Branding the American West form part of this exhibit today. And I hope that we can consider, as an academic community and as Americans, what will we do? Thank you.
Is it on now? Yeah, okay. So I just want to give my thanks to all of these contributors to our project. It's been a delight to work with them. I think that our biggest challenge in working with each other was the technical difficulties today. I know that the Charles Redd Center for Western Studies here at BYU and the Stark Foundation in Orange, Texas, that brought us all together at both places to look at the works and hone a thesis, and it was a collaborative project from the start. Now, LeAnne joined us in BYU via webcam, so she was actually never at the project, but never with us all together. But I remember one thing she said in her webcast, and that was that she urged us all to refer to each other's work in our book. And I think you've seen that happen today just in the talks that they made. We went over time because of the technical difficulties, so I just would, if any of you have a comment about how helpful it was to know what other people were working on in the catalog, if you would please make a comment about that.
Scott sending me things and Elizabeth sending me things, and I just really benefited from their work and from their insights. Really was just critical to doing what I could do. Couldn't have done it without them.
Very generous in helping us poor historians understand.
Yeah.
And it was just, everyone knew what each other was writing. It was great. And presented the work in rough stages at the beginning. And that was very wonderful for me to see personally. And I enjoyed working with Sarah Boehme at the Stark. The germ of this idea occurred in 2008 at the Dallas CAA convention. And we haven't worked on it entirely since that time, but it was a germ that was conceived at that time. And I'm delighted to see the outcome of it. Also, one of our reporters in a local paper talked to Dean Rader and Elizabeth. And I think it was Elizabeth in her comments talked about the importance of seeing all of the works of art together. I wonder if you just might share something about that.
Yeah, I mean, I was going to make a comment earlier, too, about... I think we got committed to the collections and to the checklist, too. So it wasn't only knowing what each other were doing thematically in their work, but who was going to make sure that this piece got the dignity and the sort of consideration that it merited. And so we kind of adopted some of the pieces and swapped them a little bit as well. And I do think that, you know, as I mentioned in my comments, both Jimmy and I wouldn't have come up with our topics if we hadn't looked at the works in person. And perhaps there's an impression here among historians that like hanging out in vaults of paintings is what art historians do all day. But mostly we're like grading papers and, you know, attending committee meetings. So it was delicious. And really just, I say that because sort of the very visceral opportunity to be in the presence of this work and say to Sarah, no, we want 5 more minutes with this thing out, but you can't put this one away and pull out the next one, or, you know, how does this bear painting by Dunton compare to that bear painting by Dunton? Like, it, you can do things in the real context of the works that you can never do just calling them up on your screen where all of their texture is flattened, they're all exactly the same size, they've been color corrected to be homogeneous. So curators, please find some funding and do this, and it will reward everyone.
Yeah, thank you, Elizabeth. And I think there's probably a couple of, we'll take 2 questions from the audience if you have them. Okay, Jane.
I haven't had a chance to look at the exhibit catalog, but I just wonder if anybody talks about the Taos Pueblo artists, Pop Chali, John Suazo, Sharon Dryflower, Diane Reyna. I mean, there are many, many, and a lot of the talks has centered around people in Taos who, in a generous word, utilized Pueblo in their work. Mm-hmm. But does anybody talk about the Pueblo artists themselves?
We don't, and that's very unfortunate. Now, we have to realize that we started with 2 collections, and so we worked from what were in those collections. So it's a much deeper project than what we came up with, because we were working with the 2 collections that we had. And in our collection, we don't have any of those artists. So,
but
yes.
We do have other Pueblo artists in the BYU collection, Nuria Montoya's, Norman Marshall,
yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Well, Sarah might want to respond to that, because when we organized this, we were primarily focusing on the Maynard Dixon collections from BYU and the Pueblo paintings from Taos, Taos Pueblo paintings from the Stark. Sarah, do you have a comment?
Just that's part of the need to go further now. Focusing on our collection, historically it was a collection of a private collector with a viewpoint of the 40s and 50s. And he did collect some American Indian paintings, very, very limited. And I think we need, you know, it's part of expanding the canon that needs to be done.
Yeah. And there's another difference here. Maybe since this is an interdisciplinary conference, I can just mention that briefly. When in my impression is that when a historian writes an essay and they want to use images, they pick images to illustrate their point they're making in their essay. Now, if somebody disagrees with that, you tell me. But art historians have a little bit different approach. They begin with the works and see what the works say. And the message comes out of that. So when we began with works that didn't include these other Pueblo artists, the other artists did not, their messages did not come out. You see what I'm saying? And I think that maybe it would be great for us to expand it at another point and include more. Does that help you understand, Jane? It's not an excuse, but except that we were working from the collections we had. Okay. Any other question? Elisa. They're not in the collection, and that was one of my sorrows, because, as some of my colleagues can attest, wanting to include.
Yeah, you had asked me kind of point blank, like you want to work on, because the essay that she mentioned about performing in red face, I talk about the kind of how the Nuevo Mexicano, in some ways, is the obverse, right, of the kind of Native American image, and without the kind of whiff of romance, that they're only presented as just being impoverished. And of course, you know, Jimmy did a great job with the plasterers in his own essay. But, you know, the Tao Society of Artists in general, there's very few of those images, and I think fewer still in the two collections.
Yes, I wanted the Mexican-American influence there because at the time we're dealing with the Mexican-Americans were the largest percentage of the population. You see that in the census records, but it is not reflected in the art. It's not.
Yeah.
Jump in too, and I've said this to a couple of you in conversation, one of the things that is idiosyncratic and generative about this project is that there was no doling out of jobs to the collaborators. And there, as a result of the fact that the topics that we ended up writing about, or at least many of us, came out of our encounters with the works themselves, there are some omissions. But there are also works themselves and topics that come out of this collection itself that aren't dealt with, like gender. I mean, the representations of women in those collections show up in this show, but not as strongly as they might have. And I think that there were a lot of difficult choices to go with what individual scholars found resonated with other kinds of questions that they were asking. I know that my choices had a lot to do with being quite close with an archaeology project going on in northern New Mexico about the Comanche, Jicarilla, and Taos exchanges, which is not so much documented in the paintings by Pueblo people, which have a different and important history. So it's a little idiosyncratic. And I think that's one of the things that a collaborative project forces you to do, right, is to not necessarily write a recipe and get everything covered that you expected to get covered, but perhaps allow, and one of the things that I do think is vital about this project is it's not just that we're in different disciplines, we have different voices, we have different ways of doing our work, and I think the catalog preserves that, you know, starting and ending with our creative writers who are also obviously breathtaking scholars in their own right, but Dean's piece doesn't necessarily read like the dense academic prose that I make you suffer with somewhere closer to the middle of the catalog. So that's a plus, and there are many minuses, many.
Yeah. So if you're staying around, we're past time here, we need to move on, but if you're staying around, please feel, and if our panelists are staying around, I know Elizabeth wants to head to Zions, but anyway.
I'll still talk.
If you're staying around for a little while, please feel free to come up and talk to the panelists, any questions you have. But I highly recommend such a collaborative project, interdisciplinary. It's just wonderful. The perspectives become so broad and the questions become so broad. And I guess you could answer more questions if you included more scholars. But it was wonderful. Thank you very much.